You know, for the longest time, the world of economics was pretty much ruled by one single powerful idea, that governments should just get out of the way and let things be. But what happens when the very system that's supposed to fix itself just completely breaks down?
All right, let's really get into it. Because that one simple question, well, it sparked one of the biggest revolutions in the entire history of economics.
So, to really understand this revolution, we've got to rewind the clock a bit. We need to see what the world looked like before everything came crashing down. See, before the 1930s, almost every economist on the planet was on the same page. They all followed what we now call the classical approach.
And the logic, which came from thinkers like Adam Smith, seemed pretty solid, right? This whole concept of the invisible hand basically said the market is like a self-healing machine. For example, if there's high unemployment, no big deal. Wages will just naturally fall. That makes it cheaper for businesses to hire people, and boom, just like that, the unemployment problem solves itself. The thinking was, any government interference would just throw a wrench into this perfect natural process.
So you've got this massive clash of ideas right here. On one side, you have the leave-it-alone camp, and on the other, this totally radical new idea that a huge, huge crisis was about to shove right into the spotlight. And then 1929 happened. That crisis finally hit. And it wasn't just some downturn, it was an absolute economic catastrophe. A collapse so total, it didn't just challenge the old way of thinking, it completely shattered it. It all kicked off in October 1929, when the US stock market imploded. But here's the thing, it wasn't just wealthy investors who got wiped out, it was the banks. Back then, there were basically no regulations to protect them, so they failed. And when the banks fail, the businesses that depend on them, they collapse too. And this thing wasn't contained. Oh no, it went viral. The US stopped buying goods from Britain, so Britain's economy nosedived, and from there, it just spread across Europe like a disease.
At its absolute worst, this was the unemployment rate in the United States, 25%. I mean, just let that sink in. One out of every four people was out of a job. This wasn't a temporary dip. This was a complete and utter system failure.
Now, here's what's so fascinating about this whole period. It was the ultimate real-world test for that classical theory. The theory said the market would self-correct, but it didn't. 1930 came and went, then 1931, and things only got worse. That famous invisible hand was absolutely nowhere to be found. So why? Why couldn't the economy pull itself out of this nosedive? Well, the answer is a terrifyingly logical trap. A self-reinforcing cycle that just kept dragging everything further and further down. Okay, let's walk through this, because it's chilling. When the crisis hit, people got scared and slammed their wallet shut. They just stopped buying things. So, of course, businesses, seeing no demand, had to start firing workers. But now, those newly unemployed workers had zero income, which meant they bought even less. That forced businesses to fire more workers. And you can see where this is going. The whole economy just spiraled deeper and deeper into a black hole.
And it's into this absolute chaos that an economist named John Maynard Keynes steps onto the scene. He takes one look at this horrifying downward spiral and comes to a conclusion that would literally change the world. So here's his crucial insight. Keynes argued everyone was looking at the wrong thing. The factories weren't broken. The workers were desperate to work. The problem wasn't with supply. It was that no one, not consumers, not businesses, had the money or the confidence to buy anything. It was a catastrophic failure of demand. And his solution, which is really captured in this idea, was completely radical at the time. He argued that the one institution that classical economics had forbidden from ever getting involved, the government, was now the only one powerful enough to step in and save the day.
So how exactly was the government supposed to do that? How could it suddenly become the engine of the economy? Well, Keynes laid out a pretty clear and practical plan. Instead of that vicious cycle pulling everything down, Keynes said you just had to create a virtuous one to pull it all back up. Here's how it works. The government kickstarts it by spending money. It hires unemployed people for massive public works projects, building roads, dams, schools. All of a sudden, those people have a salary. And what do you do with a salary? You spend it. And when they start buying stuff again, businesses see that demand picking up and start hiring more workers to meet it. The engine starts turning again. So Keynes basically gave governments two main tools they could use. First, directly increase government spending. That's the G in the economic models.
That creates jobs and demand right out of the gate. The second tool? Cut taxes. This one's pretty simple. It just leaves more money in people's pockets, which boosts their ability to spend and fuels the economy from the bottom up. And hey, this wasn't just some theory in a textbook. We've seen it work in the real world. The massive government spending during World War II is what finally pulled countries out of the Great Depression. After the war, the Marshall Plan rebuilt Europe with a huge injection of funds. Even in the 1990s, when Israel absorbed a massive wave of new immigrants, the government gave them an absorption basket full of money. And what did they do? They immediately spent it, which boosted demand and created jobs.
And so, from the 1930s all the way through the 1980s, Keynes's big idea that a government could and should actively manage its economy became the dominant playbook across the entire globe. It was a total paradigm shift.
The Keynesian revolution gave governments these powerful new tools to fight off economic disaster, but it also left us with this central debate that is still raging to this day. When should the government step in, and when should it just step back? It's a fundamental question that really every generation has to answer for itself.